earlier than we usually get here. Wow. Maybe my watch stuff.
Good morning, church. Let's stand and praise God together through song.
I am just a weary pilgrim, plodding through this world of sin, getting ready for that city when the saints go marching in. Oh, when the saints go marching in. Oh, when the saints go from sin with extent.
Amen. Amen. Please be seated.
I am here. You know, you forget little things like you're getting ready, calm and ready for the service to begin, and realize, oh, I never put on a microphone. So here I am. So this morning, it's great to have you at McQueenie Baptist Church. Welcome. Don and I had a good week off last week. Connor did a great job preaching in my absence, and I really appreciate him for doing that. And this is not announcement time, but I want to say right off the bat to everybody that came out yesterday and helped with the spring cleaning and sprucing the church up, I want to say a great big thank you to all of you. I came back up here yesterday at 6, and there are a couple of people still here working. Okay, Scott Boyd, that's one of them, and John Norris, another. And I appreciate all the work that you guys did making the church look so much better. Thank you. So this morning, we're really glad you're here, but we would love to have a record of your presence in the service today. Members, visitors, everybody. And so we're going to give you a minute and a half right now just to fill out the little connection card that's in your bulletin. You'll see it's attached. If you'll take the next minute and a half to fill that out, we would appreciate it so much. Thank you.
Let's continue praising God through song.
There is a name I love to hear. I love to sing its word. It sounds like music in my ear. The sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. He tells me of a Savior's love who died to save. Oh,
When my life work is ended and I cross the swelling tide, when the bright and glorious morning I shall see, I shall know my Redeemer when I reach the other side, and his smile will be the first to welcome me. I shall know. Seated. Teresa,
don't know how it is you looked at me and saw the person that I could be. Awaken in my heart and breaking through the dark, suddenly your grace. Like sunlight burning at midnight, making my love something so beautiful, beautiful. Mercy reaching to save me, all that I need. You are so beautiful, beautiful. There's a joy inside I can't contain, but even perfect days can end in rain. And though it's pouring down, I see you through the clouds shining on my face. Like sunlight burning at midnight, making my love something so beautiful. Mercy reaching to save me, all that I need. You are so beautiful, beautiful. I have come undone, but I have just begun changing by your grace.
Was from the beginning, which we have
heard, which we have seen with our eyes,
which we looked upon and have touched with our hands, concerning the word of life.
The life was made manifest, and we have
seen it and testified to it,
and proclaim to you the eternal life,
which was with the Father and was
made manifest to us.
That which we have seen and heard,
we proclaim also to you,
so that you too may have fellowship with us.
And indeed, our
fellowship is with the Father
and with his Son,
Jesus Christ.
And we are writing these things
so that our joy may be complete.
I made a profession of faith in Jesus Christ when I was 7 years old. And I was baptized at Calvary Baptist Church in Huntsville. Actually, I was baptized at another church in Huntsville because Calvary Baptist at that time did not have a baptistry. So our church had to borrow. We were a very small country church, okay? But I made a profession of faith, was baptized, and then went along in my life. And then when I got to be about 13 years old, frankly, I heard a message that was preached out of one of the texts that I'm going to be talking about in just a few moments that's found in the Gospel of Matthew. And I began to really question, well, whether I was saved or not. I just thought, you know, I don't think I'm saved. And so I went forward at the invitation and I gave my heart to Jesus again. And I was baptized a second time. I'm not sure, but there may have been another one in there somewhere down the road. But let me just ask you a question this morning. How many of you have actually experienced something similar to what I just described? You made a profession of faith, you were baptized, and then at some point down the road, you really questioned that salvation, and you were baptized again. Raise your hands if you experienced that, okay? Anybody here do that more than three times? Okay, because I was listening to one guy that I know talk about that he was baptized four times in his life. Always questioning, always wondering, you know, am I really saved? Am I really born again? And so that's what I want to talk about over the next few weeks. We're going to be doing a message series through the book of 1 John. And this morning, I want to start by reading the text that kind of brought me to a question mark in my life. So let's read it together. This text is found in Matthew chapter 7, verse 21. It'll be familiar to many of you who have been in church very long. It'll be maybe unfamiliar to some of you. It'll probably be a little scary to everybody. This is what it says. Not everyone, this is Jesus speaking, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and in your name drive out demons and in your name perform many miracles? Then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. That is a sobering text, is it not? For all of us. And so out of this, what I want to do over the next few weeks is I want to talk about what it is that God really desires for each of us. I mean, when I read that text, as I did when I was 14 years old, and I hear that not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. I said, well, I prayed a prayer, and I said, Lord, Lord. You know, I prayed the prayer. I prayed that prayer, right? But it says not everybody that says, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. He says, many will say to me on that day, did we not prophesy? Did we not preach? Did we not teach? Did we do many miracles? Did we cast out demons? I don't know about you, but those are all kind of trademark signs to me of someone that would have the power of God and would be someone acceptable in the kingdom. Now, I'm not going to break that passage down for you, but just let me give you a couple of quick thoughts on that before we move on. And that is that God is not the only one who can actually do things that look like miracles. I mean, think about Moses in the court of Pharaoh as he confronted those magicians. And so there will be many that will say to the Lord on that day, we did some great miracles. We did some great things. We drove out demons. Well, you know, Jesus was once accused of casting out demons by the power of the devil, which is a blasphemy. But let me just tell you, the devil himself has authority over the demons that serve under him. And if it serves his purpose, the Bible says that the devil comes to us dressed like an angel of light. He comes to us a wolf in sheep's clothing, and he will do anything that he can to confuse those who say or want to believe that they are Christians. So when you read this passage, we ask the question, how do we know? There are two things that this series that I'm going to be preaching is going to do prayerfully concerning salvation. Okay? The first is this. It will comfort those who are unnecessarily troubled. It will comfort those who are unnecessarily troubled, but it will also trouble those who are unjustifiably comforted. The question I want to begin with this morning as we look at 1 John is this. Does God really want us to know for sure that we are saved? What do we mean by saved? Well, we mean someone who was once in their sins, separated from God. Who, if they remain in their sins until they die, will not be accepted into the kingdom of God, into heaven, but will instead be appointed to eternity in hell. So I would say, is this not a really important question? This is not just about religion. It's not just about denomination. It's not just about, you know, whether we're good people or bad people, you know, in terms of what the world says. The question is, does God really want me to know that I am born again, that I'm saved, and that I have an eternity in heaven with him? Some would say to that question, no, he does not want you to know for sure. In other words, they would say that this is God's way. For you not being sure is God's way of kind of keeping you on the right track. As long as you're not sure, as long as you don't know, it's like that carrot being dangled out in front of the horse to keep the horse moving forward. As long as we don't know the answer to that question, then we're going to keep striving to try to prove ourselves. Some would say, no, God doesn't want you to know. Some would say, yes, God does want you to know. And one of the people that wants you to know, that wanted you to have an answer to that question, was the Apostle John. He is the one who walked with Jesus through his whole life, through the life of Jesus, through his ministry years. He is the one that the Bible says leaned on his breast at the Last Supper, one who was close to him in the inner circle of his disciples. John was a devout follower of Jesus, and this is evidenced in his gospel that he wrote, and it's evidenced in the books that he wrote, the epistles. And this is what John said in 1 John chapter 5, verse 13. You say, wait a minute, Pastor, you said you're going to preach through 1 John. You already reached the end because that's the last chapter. No, we're going to start with the beginning. I mean, with the ending, okay? We're going to start with the ending where John answers an important question. This is what he says, 1 John chapter 5, verse 13. I write these things. What things? The things that he has given to us in the book of 1 John that we're going to be looking at. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. I'm writing these things to you so that you may know with a certainty that you have eternal life. Now, he doesn't say this, but I think this is implied. That if he wants you to know with a certainty that you have eternal life, I believe he would also like you to know with a certainty that you do not. In other words, we don't want to be left wondering. This is John's stated intended purpose for writing the book of 1 John. I think it's tremendously important. I think it's tremendously important to all of us that we evaluate, look at our lives in relation to what John is going to write us in the book of 1 John. So John would want you to know. Why? Because God wants you to know. There are two reasons that I believe John and God want you to know that you have eternal life. The first one is that he loves you. He loves us. The second is that real love only grows in the soil of security. And we're going to unpack that a little bit more in the rest of this message. First is that he loves you. He wants you to know for sure that you're saved. Why? Because he loves you. And the second thing, he wants you to know for sure so because obedience and love can only grow in the soil of security. So let's look at that first one. Number one, we are God's beloved children. He wants you to know that you're saved. He wants you to know that you have an eternal relationship with him because you are God's beloved children. Now, as we look at this, we're going to jump over to the gospel that John wrote. By the way, the first two sermons in this series are going to be based on the end of the gospel of John, answering the question, does God really want us to know that we're saved? And the second we're going to talk about next week, well, then how do we know that? So John gave us some other things in the gospel that he wrote related to our relationship to our Heavenly Father. John 14, 18 says this, Jesus speaking to his disciples says, I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. I will not leave you as orphans. Our Heavenly Father does not want us to go through life as if we were orphans, as if we have no father. A good father does not want his children wondering whether or not he loves them or is committed to them. Right? A good father wants his children to know that he loves them. You know, if you leave on a trip, dads and all the dads, if you leave on a trip, you're going somewhere. I can remember going on a few trips in my life and leaving my wife and children and, you know, saying to them, Daddy's going to be home soon. Or maybe he won't. Who knows? When I come, I'll bring you a gift. That is if I come back. If I do return, which I may not, You know, the question, do you really have a daddy or not? That's really, I don't know. Maybe I've got a family somewhere else. You're really not my, maybe you're illegitimate children. I've got another family somewhere else. I'm going to go and be with them. But, you know, I love you kids. What dad would say that to their children? What dad would want his children to believe that they are left behind, that they're not loved? He doesn't. And you know that fear that we have to live up to that and we have to earn that love, we have to build that love, we have to grasp that love, we have to go after that love, we have to retain that love. The fear that we have to do that may produce some level of obedience in our lives, right? In fact, I have seen that in relationships with children with their parents, right? Maybe some of you in here this morning have lived a life like that where you felt like you're always having to prove yourself to your mom or your dad so that you could earn their love and that you would know that they would be there for you, that they really did care about you, that they really did love you, that they really were proud of you. I've seen that many, many times in my lifetime as a pastor. A good father wants his children to know beyond any shadow of a doubt that he loves them. And it's an unconditional love. Jeremiah 31:3, I love this passage. It says, the Lord appeared to us in the past saying, I have loved you with an everlasting love. I have drawn you with unfailing kindness. How has God loved you? With an everlasting love. A love that draws you by its kindness. That is the God that we serve. That is the Lord that we walk with. That is the one who reaches out to us and wants us to know beyond any shadow of a doubt that he loves us. And if our Father loves us, he doesn't want us walking in uncertainty about that love. So that's kind of a simple beginning place, isn't it? The Bible says, and we're going to study this as we go through 1 John. John says, we know that God loves us because God is love. God is the very source of love. And so that Father that loves us wants us to know for sure that we have a relationship with him that will end in eternal life with him. The second thing is this. We are God's betrothed bride. We can know that God wants us to know our relationship to him is secure. We can rest assured in the knowledge that we are born again, we are saved. Why? Because we are the bride of Christ. You are the betrothed bride of Jesus Christ. John says this in John 14:1-3. He says, do not let your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. He says, my Father's house has many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? You know, we just recently lost one of our wonderful church members. Rich Lorton went on to be with the Lord. And, you know, probably the day before, the 2 days before, and I was sitting by his bedside, that's what I quoted to him. You know, he was ready to go. And to be able to say to someone, do not let your heart be troubled. You believe in God. Believe also in me. Believe in me, Jesus said. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I do that, I'm going to come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. John is telling us the heart of God, that we are his betrothed bride. You know, Jesus was getting ready. When he gave this, he was getting ready to leave his disciples. The time was coming when his death and the separation would be very painful. But he's wanting his children to know that they will not be left alone. They will not be left as orphans, as we read in the other passage. You know, Don and I, as I've shared with y'all before, you know, we got married pretty young. And I lived in Huntsville, and Donna lived in Houston. Huntsville, Texas was about an hour and a half drive down from Houston. And so we were really young, and I tell you what, as young as I was, I knew I loved her, and I believed that she loved me. So the time came when we got engaged. Why do you get engaged? What is the purpose of engagement? What is the purpose, as the Bible uses the term, being betrothed, being promised to one another? What is the purpose in doing that? Well, one of my purposes was that I didn't want anybody else hitting on her. I wanted them to know, see, that she was already taken. She had a ring. She was already taken. I didn't want anybody hitting on her, especially being kind of separated at that time and not really being together. And so why would she talk to somebody else when she has already been promised to me? Why would she speak to someone else? Why would she go with someone else or go out with someone else when I've already promised her that I'm coming for her? In other words, why would she want to fool around with anybody else when she's got the secret sauce right here? She's got the awesome sauce right here. And so we make that promise, right? Yeah, I'll pay for that one. Let's not miss this. Let's not miss it. Throughout the Word of God, from start to finish, is about our God wanting to know that He loves us. And He has done everything within His ability and power to bring us into a relationship with Him. I've heard questions. Well, if God loves us so much, why didn't He just make us, you know, where we just loved Him? And there was no question marks. There was no ifs, ands, or buts. Well, what we're going to learn is through the book of 1 John is that love can only exist in freedom. And it can only exist in a context where there's freedom in that relationship. Any man that holds on to his wife by force is not building a love relationship. You know, you've heard it said many times, and I've said this so many times over the many years in marriage counseling with people. I've had to try to get across to people. You think we would get this, right? I've tried to get across them. Until you let her go, until you let him go, you cannot keep him. You cannot keep her until they're free to either stay or go. God gives us that same freedom. That's why he wrote in Ephesians chapter 5. This is a bit of a long, but I want you to listen to this in the context of what we are talking about this morning. Ephesians 5, 22 through 33, talking about a relationship between husbands and wives. Wives, submit yourselves to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife as Christ is the head of the church, his body of which he is the Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Not very politically correct today, is it? But scripturally accurate and true. Then he goes on to say, but husbands, love your wives, just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Christ gave himself up for the church to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. In the same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated their own body, but they feed and take care of their body, just as Christ does the church. For we are members of his body. He says, for this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. Now I want you to listen carefully to the next part, okay? This, Paul says, this is a profound mystery. But I am talking about Christ and the church. All of this talk about wives submitting to your husbands and husbands loving your wives and the cleansing of the bride and the preparation that goes into a marriage relationship. He says, here's what I want you to know, that actually this is a mystery, but I'm talking about Christ and his church. You see, Jesus wants you to know, God wants you to know that you are his betrothed bride. You are engaged to Jesus. And one day he's coming. You are the bride of Christ. One day he's coming to receive his church to himself. He will come for you if you are truly his bride. I want to give you a wonderful gospel mystery this morning. And that is that love, that is that assurance of a relationship, assurance of salvation, can only flourish in a context of security and certainty and freedom. You know, the idea that God would not want us to be sure that we're saved will produce in us a fear. Think about that. Uncertainty of your salvation will produce an anxiety and a fear. You say, well, you ought to be afraid. Not if you're saved. Not if you're a child of God. Because my Bible says perfect love casts out fear. When love is made perfect in Christ, in that relationship, it will drive out all fear. John says it this way in 1 John chapter 4, verse 9. We're not there in our study yet, but 1 John chapter 4, verse 19, we're asked the question, why do we love God? Why do we love God? John's answer is this: because he first loved me. We love God because he first loved us. There's a book written many years ago, movie been made about it, it's been on the stage, Les Miserables. I don't know if you've ever seen the movie or been to the stage performance. But in this story, Valjean experiences this incredible act. This main character throughout the book, throughout the movie, experiences this amazing, incredible act of grace when a priest, instead of extending justice to him, extends mercy instead. Now, Valjean had spent his entire life, 20 years or over 20 years, refusing to bend and be broken by the expectations of others that were around him, those that were seeking to capture him. I don't know if you're familiar with the story. It's a great story. But after coming into contact and face to face with this priest who extends mercy instead of grace, for the first time, he begins to bend. Hugo said this, he wrote this. He says, Valjean dimly felt that this priest's pardon was the hardest assault of all, the most formidable attack he had ever sustained. In other words, all the threats of jail, all the threats that he had been placed on his life, he said it was finally the mercy of this priest that began to bend him. That a gigantic and decisive struggle had begun in his heart between his own wrongs and the goodness of the man that he had met. I wish sometimes, you know, we could just tell all of our story. But you know, we've all experienced, I don't know if you have or not, but having broken a faith or having broken a trust, do you know how hard it is? Hard to rebuild, isn't it? And I know in my own life I've experienced times like that where broken trust resulted in a break in my relationship. Not we were separated, divorced, but that there was a break in the relationship. And I've experienced in my life, I've experienced both the result of an anger and a refusal to forgive. And then I've experienced grace in our relationship. And here's what I've learned. I've learned that grace is the more powerful. Grace extended has always proved in me a greater source to change than threats ever did. You will never advance spiritually until you rest assured that He is yours and you are His. That's why we're studying 1 John. Heavenly Father, we thank You this morning for Your amazing grace. And Lord, it becomes so evident, so real when we realize that it isn't the threats of punishment or eternity without in hell that move us, but Lord, it is the love that You've extended to us through Your Son, Jesus Christ. It is that You loved us first. Thus, Lord, we have a pathway to love You, know You. So, Lord, I pray for Your people this morning. Lord, I pray that through the next weeks, Lord, we could come to rest assured in the salvation that You have given to us, that You not only want us to know, but You will show us how we can know. So, Lord, in these things, I give You praise and honor and glory. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Would you stand with me as we go into this time of invitation today? I don't know what God may be saying to you. Maybe you are here today and you know that you've never made the decision to trust Christ as your Savior. You've never really experienced personally the love of Christ in your life. You know about it, but you haven't actually experienced it. Let me tell you, it's as simple as letting down, letting go, and inviting Him to take control of your life. You know, the power, by the way, listen, the power isn't in the prayer that you say, but is in what's in the heart of the one who's saying it. And if you give your heart and life to Jesus Christ, I want you to know today that you can rest assured in that salvation. If you've never done that, I would love to pray with you this morning. Maybe God is speaking to you in some other way that I don't even know about this morning, but whatever it is, the altar will be open. If you just want to come and pray, I will pray with anybody that has a need. Just be obedient and follow the love of Christ this morning as we worship together.
All to Jesus I surrender, all to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him, in His presence daily live. I surrender.
Seated. Where did I leave my book there? Because I need these announcements out of here. All right. There we go. All right. So thank y'all so much for being here this morning. And once again, I also wanted to throw out a special thank you to Dean Johnson. Dean's sitting back there in the back. Dean is the chairman of our maintenance and grounds committee. And I just want you to know, Dean, you did a great job of organizing a really good work day. We got a lot of things accomplished yesterday that has been needing to be done, and so I appreciate it. I also want to kind of toss out a thank you to our youth group. Our youth were here yesterday, Connor, David leading out, and then our young people were here working. They worked hard, too. So just want to say God bless you. Still a lot of things we need to get done, but we've got a great, great start and got a lot of things finished. So this evening, we have business meeting this evening at 5 o'clock. So we'll meet right here at 5 o'clock this evening, you know, to talk about the direction of our church, the things that are happening, the things that are coming up. So 5 o'clock this afternoon, church business meeting right here in the auditorium. Also, the Easter musical is coming up fast, isn't it, Joe? Yeah. So, and the evidence of that can be seen up here on the stage. I'm getting more and more excited every week as this continues to come together. Next Saturday is a dress rehearsal for those that are involved. It's going to be dress rehearsal next week. Rehearsals also today at noon for the drama, and then this evening for the choir at 6. And then the performances will be on Palm Sunday. That will be at 3 o'clock and at 6 o'clock on Palm Sunday, which will be next Sunday evening. Okay? All right. Anything you want to add, Joe? Nope? Okay. Also, with Easter coming up, we're planning a special Easter services, and we always do a little Easter egg hunt for the kids right after our second service is over on Easter Sunday. And so if you would, bring your candy-filled eggs. And, you know, last year we had so many that we had to actually end up picking them up ourselves, the adults, because there was just too many. We will tell you this year, we will tell you when we have enough, okay? So until then, just bring some candy eggs. And then last but not least, our car show is coming up on April the 30th, the last Saturday in the month of April. And you've seen the sign-up sheets back there. Today is the last day to sign up as a volunteer if you want to be able to get one of the T-shirts that are being made for the car show. So they're free to everybody, but you get one if you sign up to volunteer, if you do it by today. That's why I realized I'm promoting this like crazy and realized it had nowhere where Don and I on the list. So I got us on the list and got the T-shirt ordered, okay? So you need to do that. And by the way, if you look at those lists and you see something, say, well, I was going to volunteer to do this, but it's already full of volunteers. Wayman said, please don't let that deter you. We want everybody to be a part of it. And so there's going to be lots of work to do. So if you don't sign up under one of those specific things, you just sign up, put your name in your T-shirt size, and make sure you're on the list. And we're going to make sure everybody's busy, and we're going to have a great, great time on April 30th with the car show, reaching out to our community. Thank you so much for being. Yes, thank you. I'm out of practice. I've been out a week, and I'm out of practice. The connection cards that you have, would y'all take those out right now and pass them to the center aisle, please? Thank you. How'd Connor do on the announcements last week? He did okay? He did great. Oh, thank you very much. Connor did great. You're like, okay. I know. I mess it up all the time. Thank y'all for filling those out. We just really appreciate members, visitors, everybody. We just love to have a record of your presence. And also, your prayer requests on the back of those are really important to us, letting us know what's going on in your lives and how we can pray for you. And so thank y'all so much for being a part of McQueenie Baptist Church. All right, let's all stand together and we will be dismissed. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for the opportunity we've had today to come into your house and to worship. Lord, we thank you for eternal life. And we thank you, Lord, for the assurance that you will surely give us over these next weeks, Lord, as we examine that we can walk strong in our faith and that we can rest assured in the salvation that you've given to us. Lord, we ask your blessing on every person here today as they go. Keep them safe in their journey. Watch over them. Father, guide them along their way. Bring us back together again. Lord, we pray in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. God bless you.